Welcome to the First Unitarian Universalist Church of Richmond. My name is Suzanne Short, and I'm pleased to be serving this community on its board of directors. I had hoped for the first time in 2 years to be addressing you from the Great Hall at our church, but Mother Nature has decided once again to show us who is in control. So sit back and enjoy a lovely snowy day and stay warm. I especially want to welcome friends and members from our Eno River congregation as well. Hopefully you're seeing us without the snow. If you're a visitor here today, we're so glad that you found us. We welcome you and thank you for spending time with us, and we hope you will come back again soon. Our church was begun in 1833 as a liberal Christian community. We're now a community of many faith journeys and beliefs, guided not by a creed, but by a covenant to uphold shared principles marked by love, respect, and justice. Our faith community continues to work together to put our UU principles and values into action and build beloved community and serve the purpose of justice for all in the Richmond community. We welcome you to live these principles with us as you continue your spiritual journey. If you're a visitor here today or new to Unitarian Universalism and would like to learn more about our faith and our community, we invite you to check out our website, join our Facebook group, and reach out by email at membership@richmonduu.org. We hope you will join us at our virtual coffee hour following this morning's service through a separate Zoom link available in this morning's email and on our Facebook site. Coffee hour provides a time to connect with fellow church members, visit with friends new and old, and if you are new to First UU or a visitor with us today, a time for us to get to know you better and a chance for you to get to know us. I would like to encourage church members and visitors to tune into our Sunday morning services 5 to 10 minutes early to catch the rolling announcements and to also check out the various editions of First News Weekly every week. This is a great way to stay informed concerning important news and activities occurring in our church community. I have a special announcement for Sunday, January 23rd. Please join the board of directors and the Leadership Development Committee from noon to 1:15 p.m. on January 23rd for an update on the ministerial transition process. Christine Purcell, Transitions Program Manager at the UUA, will join us to outline the search process for an internal candidate. And the Leadership Development Committee will introduce information about the nomination process for the First UU Search Committee. The board will also answer questions about the search process. There will be opportunities in the coming weeks and months to talk through other aspects of the transition, so we will focus primarily on the nuts and bolts in this session. Information about the session and a link to the UUA website, which contains a number of great resources, can be found in First News Weeklies this past Friday and next Friday. Please note that there will be no coffee hour on January 23rd in order to make room for this session. All are welcome. Again, welcome to this joyful Sunday, made sacred by all of us being together, worshiping, and sharing our time with each other.
The world now has the means to end extreme poverty. We pray we will have the will.
Thank you, Reverend Sherman. Thank you, Suzanne. And we've enjoyed Mercy, Mercy. Wow, that's great. Thank you all for being here this morning. We weren't quite sure that it would be safe once we got out of service today. So we went with our older format from the pandemic, that of the webinar. And you're most welcome. Here's what I might be doing a little bit later today. How about you? That's Chicago, by the way. I have fun picking out the buildings I know. We want to welcome you. This is a celebration weekend in which the light that was given to us in the life of Dr. Martin Luther King and emanating from so many folks who worked with him in the civil rights struggle of the mid-20th century is ours to ponder and be inspired by. Dr. King, of course, did not work alone. Besides Coretta home, taking care of the kids and showing up and insisting that she be present with the children at many things which were often regarded as dangerous. She and others like Marion Wright, Bayard Rustin, Ralph Abernathy, Andrew Young, others were there with Dr. King, strategizing, working, planning, carrying out the ministry that he took up so that all their ministry might be effective. But there were others beyond Dr. King's circle. John Lewis stepped back from that. Fannie Lou Hamer, Diane Nash, the A&T Four who sat at the lunch counter for college-aged kids who just decided and inspired a movement that exploded across the South, including Richmond. So today is a day to celebrate, but also to contemplate. And for my last MLK service with you all, I decided that I would talk about very specifically, the thing that Dr. King focused on in the end of his days, which was poverty. And I think there's some good news for us recently on the poverty format, and there will be some backsliding. We're learning more and more about how we can reverse the tide of poverty. But as Reverend Sherman shared with you in the quote, the question is, do we have the will to do it? That's called the counting prayer, what he shared with you. It's spread across the world. There's a lot of congregations that always start with that prayer or include it in their service. So the question is, do we have the will? So today, I'd like to talk about ideas and ways in which we together can really give this some good discernment and can prepare ourselves as we come out of this pandemic to really be capable of making change. As inspired by Dr. King and generations before him and generations hence, welcome to a time of worship.
Our first reading this morning is by Imani Perry from the book, Breathe, A Letter to My Sons. I think poverty is the product of an evil way of being, of hoarding, and depriving.
Second reading this morning.
And it is part of a web. The history of conquest is a scourge on the human condition, a lingering one. The fact of the body, the fact of who has the most weapons, the fact of which gender one finds attractive and which one belongs to, regardless of the details of the flesh, these are things I believe in making free and treating tenderly. Please join me for a moment of silent meditation together this morning. Spirit, beyond all things and within all things, be with us today, distant, yet together, bonded in community. Open our hearts and minds. May we prevent one another and ourselves from becoming numb or complacent to the poverty that feels like a trap or a dead end, whether this poverty is afflicting our own lives or the lives of others, our beloveds, on this earthly home. Protect us from a failure of imagination. Crack the doors of our hearts wide that we might feel grief and motivation to heal our broken world. Commit us and help us to recommit ourselves each day to Tikkun Olam. May we turn towards one another, seal the cracks with gold, mend the brokenness with love. We pray these things in the memory of our ancestors who have come before to inspire us with their wisdom. We pray this in honor of the people of the future who we carry this world towards. May it be so. Amen.
Good morning, and thank you so much, Jamie, for playing that hymn. That's one of the hymns that have a special meaning for me. I appreciate it. And thanks to UU for selecting C2 to receive the Share the Plate this morning. My name is Lynn Edwards, and I've been a part of Coordinators 2 for more than C2 Adopt for more than 30 years, and have been so proud to be connected to the countless families and children that we've brought together through adoption. C2 Adopt is a private, nonprofit, state-licensed child placing agency who has built its reputation on three important learnings for us. The first is that adoption does not end at the final order. It's a lifetime experience for all of those who have been touched by adoption. Especially birth and adoptive families and adults like me who've been adopted. One of our learnings has been that adopted children have unique needs as a result of their life experiences actually beginning in utero, and that meeting those needs requires some special knowledge and skills and abilities of adoptive parents that they may need to learn over time and contribute to a healthy, strong attachment. And finally, that no child is unadoptable, regardless of ability, gender or sexual identification, racial and ethnic heritage, or age. We've even placed people in their 20s for adoption because everybody deserves a permanent family. We have four programs. The first is parental placement adoption, which is open infant adoption, where birth and adoptive families decide to move together towards adoption. Our waiting child program is focused on the placement of children who are waiting in foster care who've experienced multiple traumas. We take time to understand their needs and to start that process of healing for them. We recruit families who can meet those needs, educate adoptive parents about their lifetime needs, and prepare children and adoptive families for placement and support them after adoption. Our international and interracial adoption, where we address the trauma that is a part of these children's experiences and the trauma that continues after placement as children grow up in a white world in a different culture. And finally, our post-legal family support services, where we respond to the ongoing needs of families with support, education, specialized family attachment therapies that are unique in Virginia, support groups, counseling for adult adoptees and to birth parents who've placed their child. And we don't just provide that support to families that we've brought together, but to families throughout the Central Virginia region. Some of our unique actions in the community has been that we're the only agency since 1990 that has provided services to LGBTQ folks when the law and the system failed to recognize them until 2014. And we were the first agency to recruit Black families for Black children, recognizing the trauma associated with transracial placements. We were the first agency to develop a trauma-informed adoption approach to preparation, placement, post-adoption, and clinical services. More than half our services are free to families due to grants and to donations from people like you. We so appreciate your support and hope that you'll take a look at our website at C2 Adopt. The offering will now be taken and gratefully received. Thank you.
Our second reading this morning are the words from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Nobel Peace Prize address, 1964. A second evil which plagued the modern world is that of poverty. Like a monstrous octopus, it projects its nagging prehensile tentacles in land and villages all over the world. Almost 2/3 of the people of the world go to bed hungry at night. They are undernourished, ill housed, and shabbily clad. Many of them have no houses or beds to sleep in. The only beds are the sidewalks of the city and the dusty roads of the villages. Most of these poverty-stricken children of God has never seen a physician or a dentist. There is nothing new about poverty. What is new, however, is that we have the resources to get rid of it. The rich nations must use their vast resources of wealth to develop the underdeveloped, school the unschooled, and feed the unfed. Ultimately, a great nation is a compassionate nation. No individual or nation can be great if it does not have a concern for the least of these.
Thank you, Reverend Sherman. That's a 60-year-old text, and not enough has changed. Yes, it's true today, it's far more likely, almost uniformly so. The children will have seen a doctor or a dentist. And they may even see them when they need to see them, depending upon whether or not they must have co-payments for those visits. Our society has struggled with the question of poverty for a long, long time. Part of it is because we racialized poverty. Part of it is because we'd rather not have to think about assisting anyone out of our own means. And if there is a systematic effort to eliminate poverty, it will involve all of us and a rebudgeting and reallocation of money. But a really big reason that we still have poverty is that people simply are willing to tolerate it. And that's what I want to talk about today, how people are all too willing to tolerate. So this was a project that Dr. King understood well. Dr. King knew that there was racial prejudice to be found all over this country. He remarked sometimes that the northern version of prejudice was actually harder because you had to ferret it out differently than you did in the South, where it was worn with pride. But an interesting thing happened to the son of the great Atlanta preacher, Daddy King. This Morehouse man, this man who went off to study at Boston College and Crozier, and this gentleman who had what he needed in life, a family that loved him, a congregation that actually supported him as a young man, a standing in the community. There's a story that when Dr. King was traveling to organize for voting rights, that he and Ralph Bunche were meeting. Nearby, there was a school for Black children. And at lunchtime, as they were standing outside near their transportation and waiting to move to the next location they were to organize in. He and Dr. Bunch and Dr. King noticed that the school teacher had come out and brought with her an apple and a bit of crackers and bread. She then began to cut the apple among eight children and offer them a piece of bread. That was their lunch. This shocked the men. These gentlemen did not personally know hunger, but hunger is a deep part of poverty. And it can be a scarring one. I do not know how many people in our congregation in total have experienced true poverty. Some of us may have experienced it growing up. And I don't mean the kind of poverty when in college you were overdrafting in your account, but you had a place to go to and prospects and food to eat. I don't even mean the occasional time when we might have been without and really struggling and stressed to meet our bills. I mean the sleeping in your car, really hungry, suffering, unsure of whether or not you'll have housing, that kind of poverty, which still exists in many places for many people, particularly affecting young children, particularly affecting people who are hungry, much less even the people who would love to see a doctor. The extremes of poverty that still exist in our world do so primarily in sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia. We've managed to end that kind of broad and sweeping hunger in this country, but we have not eliminated all the pockets of hunger, which can be found in Richmond, in Virginia, and in this country. Just ask the folks who run the lunch and breakfast programs in the schools. Ask them if they know children who don't have enough food. Despite good efforts, very good efforts, by Feed More and others, things emerge, they arise in the family. It takes a while to address it, or the family moves and their situation is unknown. This still happens. Now, the fact that at the end of his ministry, Dr. King was dealing with poverty, not race alone, but poverty, should tell us something. Because in his ministry, he learned how essential it was to address the needs of poverty if we're going to make a difference in this world. Poverty is related to violence. Poverty is related to so many social ills and the end of social fabric for so many families. Poverty separates all kinds of people, one from another. And there are people who very intentionally and clearly separate themselves into a different caste in order to avoid poverty. Are you someone who knew poverty as a child? Are you someone who's struggling with poverty now? Fortunately, we've reduced so significantly elder poverty. The existence of Social Security has allowed us, thank goodness, to avoid those people who would simply starve at the end of their lives. But the truth of the matter is there are still people struggling with the margins. And though increases in Social Security for them have seemed significant, they're still lagging the indicators and have been for many years. Yet we decided as a society that we would address that question. Yet we haven't, as a society, decided to be as ardent in solving poverty for children who had nothing to do whatsoever with bringing that upon themselves. And that's where the title of the sermon comes from. The poor will be with you always. It is a line that is too often quoted. Christians in particular love to cite it and another line that talks about how only those who work will eat. Yet that line is meant to talk about paying attention to the teachings of Jesus while he was with his apostles. The poor will be there when you get finished, is what Jesus was probably telling his disciples. He didn't mean to ignore them when you got finished spending time with me. We in the Western world, who are deeply influenced by the Christian tradition, must come to see that this line and others, which have judged the poor harshly, have failed to look deeply into why people experience poverty, into how state and national budgets affect poverty. There's not much money left when the national budget starts with $750 billion going to the military. There is not much left in a city budget where there is a lack of business revenue. Friends, we have to see that we need a sense of savvy about this in order to do anything about poverty. Now, some good things have been happening, and they happened under the umbrella of the pandemic too. For a while, families were receiving monthly income to help them support children during the pandemic. There were effective pay raises. Fortunately, the pay of the lowest quartile in the American income scam has risen during the pandemic because there is a labor shortage. McDonald's is not yet paying $15 an hour, much less the $24 an hour they would pay if they had adjusted pay from the time they opened their doors till now, all the way through. The inequality between top earners and the bottom earners has only grown wider, and proportionately wider too, not just wider in absolute terms. And so things like mass incarceration lead to poverty. When people leave corrections and find themselves unable to get the kind of employment that will allow them to have a living wage, the lack of paid family and sick leave at the lowest quartile of jobs in terms of income means that if a child is sick, a parent might need to bring them with them or stay home or risk being fired. Still, many occupations that we rely on at grocery stores, in restaurants, will brook no time off that would be paid. a severe cold or COVID may cause irreparable financial hardship on folks that they can't recover from. And next thing you know, they're out of their apartments and into their cars. And of course, when this happens, we find people moving around and children lose their schools, their teachers, the children who are their friends, and wind up having to move around. Let's not pretend that that poverty doesn't exist among us. Now, here's a very good thing about this congregation that I'm proud of. Eviction, public schools, these things, and violence, which is caused, of course, from feeling left out and needing to engage in ways and works and gangs which give us identity or business opportunity. These are the very things that risk and our cardinal school work have focused on for a long time. I think risk has been here now, 7 years, and we've been doing the Cardinal School, formerly the Green School, for close to 25 or 30 years now. We have engaged as a group of people in a practice which challenges poverty, which does so through Share the Plate and supporting endeavors that challenge the systems of poverty that keep people from succeeding. Immigration reform is really needed to tackle some of that. There are lots of undocumented people in Richmond who bump their heads regularly against the regulations and the laws when they've been here a really long time. We also know that we have to invest in childcare, which keeps people from having the kinds of jobs that offer living wages, because it isn't affordable and it isn't available. And there's all kinds of poverty taxes, the things like paycheck companies and the sense of needing to pay excessive fines if you're late on rent or other bills. So, as I look at the life of Dr. King and the wisdom that he gained over the time of his civil rights ministry, I see that he felt compelled to change what he was doing from focusing on race to focusing on poverty, which was race focused and other elements of it, but housing was a part of it. Labor rights was a part of it. He died at the Lorraine Motel there for the sanitation workers in Memphis. So I want to ask us to think clearly about where we're going to go as we come out of this pandemic and what it is that we're going to focus on in this community, and ask you to ask one another questions about that. I could give you ideas, but I'm leaving, so I'm not going to. But I think that those who are working on issues related to challenging the injustice of poverty, particularly child poverty, ought to be in conversation with each other, ought to be examining the effects of racism on poverty, the persistence of it, and the amazing things people do to cope with it and to keep their spirits high. Those of you who have known true poverty should speak up, should share with many who are here as middle-class people who've not known it, about where you see it and how it was for you. And if you are in poverty now, please, don't hesitate to say it. The community needs to understand that we are not all professional people of a reliable income, that some of us suffer still. It is good this be known, because the community can only respond if they are deeply aware. Now, I think you know, Dr. King has been a hero in my life from the time when I was a child. I remember his influence and the marches and the speeches. Something about what he was doing was deeply attractive, and I would dare to say righteous to me. In my understanding of things as a child, that was very clear. It was clear to me that to be racist was to be wrong. And he's still teaching me about what is important in challenging the injustice of this country, even though his words speak to things that may have changed, believe me. There are people interested in keeping a servant class working for low wages with little power and above all, with very challenged rights to vote. We are privileged to have a group of people who want to work on these things out of the values we share. And so I ask us all, put our minds to the question and to start looking for the poverty that's around us, the poverty that is hidden, the poverty that is dressed up so that we don't notice, the preponderance of part-time work to avoid benefit pay and other paid time off. To challenge our vendors, to begin to understand our own power to challenge this system, to work in resisting gun violence, because there are things that can be done, not just when the mayor chooses to do them, to understand the wage system in this country and to challenge it, to ask our politicians what they are doing about the immigration status and make it plain that the immigration system helps keep people down. Do these things, ask these questions, because the poverty that we see need not always be with us, or as maybe Jesus meant to say, it's going to be there in the morning. We'll get to it then. Okay. So today, if you're doing a jigsaw puzzle or something else, use it as a time to ask yourself, where is the poverty that I encounter in my life? And how do I challenge it? How do I, in the name of all the work of anti-racism and anti-oppression, in the name of justice, what is it that I must do to begin to ferret out and end poverty here? And then we'll turn our eyes to the world. Amen. Ashe. Blessed be.
Up the broken. and brothers, anointed by God, may then create peace, where justice shall roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream. We'll be a land building up ancient cities, raising up devastations from old, restoring ruins of generations. Oh, we'll build a land of people so bold. Come build a land where sisters and brothers anointed by God may then create peace, where justice shall roll down like waters and peace like an ever-flowing stream. Come build a land where the mantles of praises resound from spirits once faint and once weak, where the oaks of righteousness stand her people. Oh, come build the land my people will seek. Come build a land where sisters and brothers anointed by God may then create peace, where justice shall roll down like waters and peace like an ever-flowing stream.
All those trapped in poverty, may they know freedom and fullness of life. For all those with insufficient income, may employment and creative new ways of earning a living open to them. For nations weighed down by unmanageable debt, may countries of wealth renew relationships into crippling burdens, relieve their suffering. And for all of us here, so aware of the problems, the hunger for change that fuels the will to change these things.
It's snowing out there. And while we're sorry we can't be together, snow, pandemic, we are united. We believe in the inherent worth and dignity of all people. We believe that we are all interrelated, connected in a garment of mutual interest, as Dr. King said. Let's celebrate the fact that we have the ability to do something wonderful about poverty. And let's resolve together to do our best to continue what we've been doing and to enlarge our hearts so that poverty ends in our lives, for the others around us and for ourselves. Maybe so. Be safe, doubly so. Enjoy the beauty of the day. And we'll see you here next Sunday. Be prepared to stay until 1:15. You guys have a lot to talk about. I will be in Florida.